Mr. Drew, in this video, we are going to be doing another fun proof by mathematical induction, and we're going to incorporate in this problem some skills or concepts that you've probably learned in your pre-calculus book or whatever course it is that you're studying in right now. We have a partial sum statement. That is definitely sort of that first introductory type problem where we're often, like in my pre-calculus book I teach from, introduced to this idea of proof by mathematical induction, but we're going to take it one step up and incorporate it with a little bit of binomial coefficient notation or a number of combinations idea. So remembering those steps of an induction proof, we're going to first show that this statement works for when n equals 1 or whatever minimum value is given for to use for n. We're going to then assume s sub k is true. And remember, this is just rewriting the given statement in terms of another variable to separate our proof from the given statement. We don't want to sort of accidentally imply that we're assuming the statement to be true that we're actually trying to prove true. So this is just a step to separate our proof from the given statement. We're then going to prove that s sub k plus 1 is true, and as you'll see me doing this proof and many, all the other induction proofs that we've done, you'll find links to those in the description below. I'm going to make the statement of s sub k so we can clearly see what the end of our proof should be looking like, and somewhere within that proof we have to use statement 2 or use the assumed to be true statement. That's often the first statement when you're dealing with partial sum formulas. The assumed to be true line may come in later in your proof if you're doing something like a divisibility or inequality type proof with induction. And then we're going to write a conclusion. Now the binomial coefficient, as a reminder, n over r. This kind of looks like vector notation too if you're studying vectors in component form, but n over r is n factorial over r factorial times n minus r factorial. Okay, so let's have some fun here. We are going to get this out of our way as quietly as possible. Okay, here we go. Let's make sure that this statement works at all for the minimum value of n for which it is stated to work. So we're going to say for n equals to 3. And you can write maybe n equals 3 or do like an s sub 3 type situation here, which is really like the very smallest partial sum, which is going to be that first term. So our first term here is 2 over 2. Is equal to, and we're doing working this for when n is equal to 3, so on the right hand side, here's our first term on the left hand. Our right hand side we have n, which we're going to be using as n equals 3 of 3, sort of over 3, but not in this sort of a fraction idea, of course. So this is going to be, remember, n and r. So the binomial coefficient says n factorial over r factorial. So 2 factorial over 2 factorial times n, which is 2, minus r, which is 2 factorial, is equal to 3 factorial on the right-hand side over 3 factorial times 3 minus 3 factorial. Well, of course, right, anything divided by itself. We have one term in the numerator, one term in the denominator. We have some factors showing up here, of course, with factorials counting down by 1 until you get to 1, but anything divided by itself is equal to 1. So 2 factorial over 2 factorial, of course, cancels out to be 1. 3 factorial divided by 3 factorial is 1. And by definition, 0 factorial is also equal to 1. So for n is equal to 3, our smallest value that n can take on, we have 1 is equal to 1, so we have shown that this statement is true for n is equal to 3. Now that we've shown that this works at least once, we are going to, okay, and I'm pausing here because like I see this s sub 3 is like a partial sum of 3 terms. Almost want to write s sub 1, but then n starts at 3, so maybe I should just say for n is equal to 3. But at any rate, our partial sum formula works for the lowest value then that we are allowed to use. Okay, so now we're going to say assume S sub k is true. And this is a really big deal. If you do not write an assumed to be true statement on a test where they are giving you method points, the grader is going to stop grading and you will not earn a method point nor any of the additional points afterwards. So this assumed to be true idea is very important, and it's also very important that we are assuming S sub k is true, not the given statement is true, even though it's going to basically look the same. So assume S sub k is true, remove, you know, again, separating our proof from the given problem, i.e. 2 over 2 plus 3 over 2 plus 4 2 plus dot 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 plus the combination of k minus 1 over 2 is equal to k over 3. Again, it's the exact same statement as the original problem, but we're just replacing n with k, which also means we need to say that k is an element of integers. That's what that double z stands for, if that's not notation in your book, and k is greater than or equal to 3. Now what we're going to try and prove true is we're going to, and this is my, I like to write this in my, in my induction proofs to give myself and my students a clear indication of what the end of the proof should look like. This is not actually the beginning of the proof yet. We're going to prove S sub k plus 1 is true, i.e. I want to take this exact same statement and basically just do a substitution of take k out and plug in k plus 1 just to see what the final end of our proof should look like. So I'm going to take out this k minus 1 and I'm going to plug in, well, I'm going to take out the k and plug in k plus 1 minus 1. Now, of course, 1 minus 1 is 0. So we go from n, the top of our binomial coefficient statement, instead of being k minus 1, it'll be k over 2 is equal to k plus 1 over 3. Now, again, what we are looking at is basically a sub 3 to a sub k, and this is basically S sub k. My proof, now this is what we assume to be true. Now we're going to add, instead of straight substitution, we're not going to take out k and plug in k plus 1. We're actually going to take this partial sum formula and add the next term to both sides. So we're going to have, as my next line of the proof, 2 over 2 plus 3 and 2 plus 4, 2 plus dot 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 plus k minus 1, 2, leave some room, k over 3. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to add that k plus 1 term to both sides. So again, we have what we have here in white was that original partial sum. Now we're coming in and we're adding the a sub k plus 1 term to both sides. We are extending that partial sum by one more general term. That means that, you know, we want to see if this is the result of adding S sub k terms and we add one more, well then this needs to be the sum of S sub k plus 1. Well, I erased it for room, but S sub k plus 1, when we did a straight substitution, is supposed to equal k plus 1 over 3. Let's see if that is indeed works out. We're going to focus on the right-hand side now. Get this out of the way. And we need to start working on making these two terms into one term. And right now there's no way to add these, so we need to go into that factorial notation using that binomial coefficient formula that I showed you a moment ago. N over R factorial is N factorial, in this case K factorial, over 3 factorial times N minus R, so K minus 3 factorial. I'm saying N, that's not the N sort of like in the original formula or the problem here we're trying to work out, that was from the binomial coefficient formula, plus, okay, K over 2, and our binomial coefficient notation is going to be K factorial over 2 factorial times K minus 2 factorial. If you don't have a strong grasp of what a factorial represents, then this problem is basically dead in the water. Let's not forget that something like 5 factorial is equal to 5 times 4 times 3 times 2 times 1. So, right, your factorial notation means that you start with the number or expression that is in front of the exclamation mark, if you will, the factorial mark, and you subtract by 1 until you get down to 1. Well, we now have two terms here that we are going to find common denominators with so that we can add them. And one of our factors in the first denominator is 3 factorial, and one of the factors in the second fraction is 2 factorial. Well, 3 factorial is 3 times 2 times 1, and 2 factorial is 2 times 1. This second fraction needs an extra factor of 3. So we're going to multiply the numerator and denominator by 3. Okay. Well, going a little bit slow, just in case there's anyone that's a little bit uneasy or unsure about factorial notation, K minus 3 factorial is K minus 3. Then the next term is going to be right minus 1. Negative 3 minus 1 is negative 4, and then you count down until you get to 3, 2, 1. And we do a lot of dots because, of course, we don't know what K represents. K minus 2 factorial is K minus 2. Now, K minus 2 minus 1 is K minus 3. Minus 1 is K minus 4, dot, 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 times 3, times 2, times 1. So we see here that the only difference between K minus 2 factorial and K minus 3 factorial is K minus 3 factorial. It's the exact same expression as we have in our, includes the same list of factors as we have as K in the K minus 2 factorial notation, except K minus 3 factorial, if it just had another factor of K minus 2, well then we would have a matching sort of expression in our denominator. So we need a K minus 2 to be multiplied to the numerator and denominator of our first fraction here. Okay, so we're going to have a new fraction with a common denominator of 3 times 2 times 1 is 3 factorial. So we have 3 factorial times K minus 2 times K minus 3 factorial, as I just showed you, is equivalent to or the same as K minus 2 factorial. Now in our numerator, we've got K factorial times K minus 2 plus K factorial times 3. So our two terms in the numerator both have a common factor of K factorial. And if I take that K factorial out, I have K minus 2 plus 3 over 3 factorial times K minus 2 factorial. Now we've got K factorial times K plus 1 over 3 factorial times K minus 2 factorial. K factorial is K times K minus 1 times K minus 2 dot 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 to 3, 2, 1. if I take that expansion and just put a k plus 1 in front of it, well, that means that k plus 1 times k factorial is just k plus 1 factorial over 3 factorial times k minus 2 factorial. Are you seeing that we're basically done? The binomial coefficient n over r is n factorial over r factorial. What's k plus 1 minus 3? K plus 1 minus 3, n minus r, k plus 1 minus 3 is k minus 2. So if I really, just to make this even clearer, we have k plus 1 factorial over 3 factorial times k plus 1, sort of that original in the binomial coefficient formula, n minus r factorial. So that is equal to k plus 1 over 3. So we got our right hand side, which was originally k over 3 plus k over 2, the sum of the original s sub k plus the a sub k plus 1 term does indeed equal the same thing that we got when we just basically plugged in, substituted in k plus 1 to see what the s sub k plus 1 formula should look like, and we're done. So what do we have here over here? I'm gonna run out of room. We have that basically our statement was, our given statement was shown to be true for n equals 3, and s sub k plus 1 is proven true assuming s sub k is true. Therefore, by the principles of mathematical induction, s sub n is proven true. And that is really cool. I'm Mr. True. Bam! Go do your homework.